Hello and welcome to a show we're calling The World in 2021. I'm François Picard. The World this week in partnership with The Daily Beast, Barbie Lazzanado, correspondent at large for The Daily Beast, joins us from Rome. How are you, Barbie?
Good to be here.
All right. With us, Borzu Daragahi, international correspondent for The Independent, who joins us from Istanbul, where you've been, what, grounded a lot of the year?
Yeah, basically.
All right. Yeah. Well, hopefully there'll be more travels in 2021 as well for Patrick Smith, editor-in-chief of the Africa Report, who is with us thanks to video link from London. Nice to see you. And here in the studio with us in the flesh, Lila Jacinto, senior editor, France24.com. Any New Year's resolutions? You've got 45 minutes.
Make it till December 31st.
Make it to December 31st. Okay. Throughout the year, The World This Week on Facebook and Twitter, hashtag World This Week. 2020 may have ended with Christmas effectively canceled in Britain, but the UK also offered humanity's down spirits a shot in the arm, if you will. Margaret Keenan, a 90-year-old pensioner, becoming the first member of the general public to receive the COVID vaccine. And there you hear the clapping, Barbie Lazzanado. You see there's light at the end of the tunnel.
That's right. I think that first shot in the arm here in Europe was absolutely the best thing that could have happened, to sort of, even though we've all gone into various stages of lockdown over the holidays, there's so much optimism that came out of that first vaccine and the belief that there is a light at the end of this horrifically dark tunnel.
Patrick Smith, are your spirits lifted?
I think we have to be, yeah. I mean, immediately there comes a question of, right, we've got the technology, we've got the science. Have we actually got the politics and the sociology and the economics to get this vaccine out? And I'm naturally concerned. I think that the top 10 richest countries in the world are going to get first dibs at this vaccine. And they should remember that until every country in the world gets access to it, it's not going to work. So they can favor themselves all they like, but it's not really going to end this pandemic until we work out a distribution system that's a lot more equitable than what we're being offered at the moment.
Yeah, in 2020, Lila Jacinto, we saw at first a race for the face masks when there weren't enough. You heard Patrick there saying it's in nobody's interest to hoard the vaccine.
Yeah, and I'm afraid if 2020 was a pandemic year, I fear that 2021 might be an infodemic year because this, you know, the vaccine was rushed through. And as Patrick said, the science is out, but now we've got to get the politics and the social readiness because there's a anti-vaxxers. There's going to be, you know, we've got to stay alert for misinformation on this vaccines. So I see a challenging year, even though it's great that these vaccines have come out. And once again, distribution. If the pandemic showed us, all the problems with inequalities, vaccine distribution is also going to bring up this issue.
It's already playing out, isn't it, on two levels. You have on the one hand, having to convince those that are skeptical. And on the other hand, those worried, like you heard Patrick say, about whether enough there'll be enough vaccine to go around.
Those are absolutely the challenges. The distribution, the Oxford vaccine, there's been a COVAX program to try and share this vaccine. So there is an awareness of it. But these are issues that we really have to take on. And we've also got to really watch for misinformation because, if there's something... If something happens, if there is a reaction, which could be a normal reaction, could this get misconstrued in this whole realm of fake news? These are the challenges now.
Yeah, so the world has to come together in order to once and for all see the back of COVID, Borzu Daragahi. And there was in 2020 an uplifting tale of globalization when it comes to this. We saw at the outset that first shot was the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine. BioNTech, which is a German startup founded by two children of Turkish immigrants. And it was in Germany seen as a positive story. And I know that... In Turkey as well.
Yeah, I mean, it was seen as a positive story in Turkey. The government took advantage of it. The newspapers touted it. Look, I think 2021 is going to be the year of the vaccine, just as 2020 was the year of the pandemic. And I think that many governments and political leaders will be judged by how well they oversee the production and distribution of the vaccine, how well they cope with it. I think, for example, in the United States, you know, really those first 100 days that everyone talks about when a new U.S. president takes over, for Joe Biden, it's going to be dominated by the vaccine rollout and how well he manages to distribute the COVID could set the tone for his entire presidency and potentially give him enough political capital to accomplish other goals.
And Borzu, to Leela's point about watch out for an infodemic in 2021, how do you roll out the vaccines in a way that the public trusts you?
I mean, weirdly, I think that there's, in general, with France actually being sort of an exception, if you look at the polling numbers, there's a lot more enthusiasm for a vaccine than there is skepticism. And, you know, I think that as I talk to people, you know, I myself, for example, have a very high risk tolerance. I'm like, oh, yeah, I'll get the jab right away. And I talk to other people who say, no, I want to wait 3 months. And I talk to other people who say, no, I want to wait even, you know, 6 months to a year before I get it to see what happens. But I think that as more people get it and no side effects take place. And I think as people start to understand the sophisticated nature of these, you know, synthesized vaccines, there'll be more of an understanding that it's not like the old polio vaccine where they shoot you up with a little bit of the disease itself, that these are, you know, this is not a live virus that they're sticking you with, that this is a, you know, kind of a antibody producer that has nothing to do with the virus.
Of course, the script could go awry. Already we have seen how the southeast of England has again been under lockdown. Patrick Smith had to catch that last Eurostar before they temporarily shut the borders with the UK. That's because of mutations of the coronavirus. Now, so far, fingers crossed, the vaccines are still effective. Let's take a listen.
Vaccination, l'idée, c'est d'avoir un spectre suffisamment large, de telle manière à, si vous avez juste une mutation à un endroit, qu'on puisse aller neutraliser à côté.
So, right now, there's cautious optimism that these vaccines will work. Patrick Smith, what's the frame of mind where you are in the UK?
Well, I think there was a panic followed by the great news. Well, preceding the great news came first of the vaccines being launched, and then all of a sudden people's spirits were brought down by the reality that there have been these mutations in the vaccine, and then there's a more virulent strain running around. I mean, people are talking about maybe each year we're going to have to get revaccinated. And the virus could mutate, so the science will just have to keep on the track. So I think it's less like it's one silver bullet, but a whole chamber full of silver bullets to be fired every year. So I think there's been a reassessment of the power of science to deal with this, and maybe the need for us to change the way we live as much as. To just go for the scientific answers to this.
Our panel pointing out how 2021 will be the year where world leaders will have to be smart in how they respond to the public health crisis aspect of it. But the pandemic response won't just be medical. The European Union still smarting from its timid response to the 2008 financial crisis that prompted a populist backlash at the polls afterwards. This time, EU leaders broke a taboo, member states overcoming the objections of fiscal hawks like the Netherlands, and for the first time agreeing to borrow, to mutualize debt in order to fund the recovery. From this crisis has an opportunity arisen if you're a believer in the European project. Barbie Latsanado.
Well, certainly here in Italy, there's a lot of optimism. You know, this is a country that is always struggling on the brink of some sort of economic disaster. And I think the recovery fund is the first time people are really looking at this as a positive way to sort of rebuild some of the broken structures. What you've got, though, is a prime minister who's not elected, Giuseppe Conte. Whether or not he can maintain support and push some of the things through that need to be pushed through in order to realize these dreams that so many Italians have is a big question on everyone's mind. But if he can stay the course, I think the recovery fund will be really good for Italy on many, many levels. And a lot of people, you know, are hoping that that's the case.
And will the European Union take the credit for it if it works?
Of course they will. I mean, Italy will never be able to
You say of course, Barbie, but we've seen in the past when something good happens, it's the local politicians who take the credit. When something bad, it's Brussels' fault.
Well, I think that's true to a certain extent, but certainly here in Italy, and I think Southern Europe as a in general, I think the European Union will say, look, we save them. You know, we help them out once again. And I think they'll take credit for that. And Italians will certainly say, well, we didn't do it ourselves. Somebody helped us out.
Yeah, how you manage the recovery is going to be, of course, the big issue. And you could say if it was a turning point for Europe, it happened on the watch of Germany. That's because Berlin, the last 6 months, has had the rotating presidency of the bloc. It's handing over to Portugal on January the 1st. How much will what's unfolded cement the legacy of Germany's chancellor, Angela Merkel? Entering now the last 9 months of a 16-year reign at Germany's last EU summit in charge, Merkel hoped that it wouldn't be just a recovery, but a legacy, a green legacy.
Die Frage unserer Verpflichtungen im Klimabereich, denn der Green Deal, das ist ja ein Kernprojekt. Wir wollen ja nicht nur ein Konjunkturprogramm auflegen, sondern auch ein Konjunkturprogramm, was uns in die Zukunft führt.
A stimulus program that leads us into the future. Borzu Dargahi, Angela Merkel, who in her 16 years, I think is close to her record highs in popularity, and not just in Germany.
Yeah, I mean, I think she has, you know, in the Trump years, taken on the mantle as the leader of the liberal world. Of the democracies of the world. Just one quick note. I just wanted to adjust one thing that Patrick had said. He said that that they had discovered that this mutation had led to a more virulent strain. It's not more virulent. It's more infectious. There's some evidence that it might be even less virulent, this new strain. I just wanted to correct that for the record. But yes, Angela Merkel, an incredible historic year as she departs from the political scene. She has become a kind of leader for, you know, an unlikely, given the fact that, you know, she was born in communist East Germany, has emerged as a leader of liberal Western democracy in these last few years as the sort of the banner holder, especially in the face of right-wing populists like Donald Trump and Viktor Orban in Hungary. Will, you know, Biden take up the banner? Will there be, will the U.S. return to the role of, you know, being the leading democracy in the world? Or will it, you know, sort of succumb to its own dysfunctions and create a sort of global vacuum in that role?
Yeah, and this idea that Europe could, for the first time, mutualize its debt so as to avert an economic catastrophe on the tail end of the slowdown of the economy due to COVID. Patrick Smith, you have, it's happened again on Angela Merkel's watch. She was the one who made this happen. Of course, in 9 months, she'll no longer be chancellor. What if it's more of a fiscal hawk who's in power in Berlin?
Well, I think that's the difficult choice that confronts Europe now. I mean, who steps into Angela Merkel's shoes? And I guess Emmanuel Macron, who has historically been more favorable to a more open-handed fiscal stance, if he takes over the role as leader of the European Union, de facto leader, after Merkel's retirement, I guess you're going to see a lot more pressure for the European Union to continue on this vein. He's going to have to convince, as you say, the Dutch and indeed Angela Merkel's successors. You've got quite a range, I mean, of people competing. You've got some center-right politicians in Germany, but the Social Democrats think it's time for them to go alone. You've got the Greens, who are also likely to be perhaps more open-handed fiscally and certainly more supportive of the Green New Deal. I think it depends very much on who wins out in the power tussle to succeed Angela Merkel, quite what Europe's stance is going to be.
Final word on this, Barbie Latsenado. Because of COVID, we kind of, I wouldn't say forgot about the climate emergency, but this talk about the Green New Deal, it's not getting as much play as one would have thought.
No, I think that's right. But I think 2021 is going to be the year that we remembered all the things we forgot during the pandemic. And maybe that's going to breathe new life into some of these movements, some of the conversations. You know, without Trump in the picture, I think we're going to see a lot more concentration on things we weren't thinking about so much. And I do think the climate crisis is definitely going to be one of those things. It's going to be a focus across Europe, especially with regard to the recovery fund. I think people can look at ways of investing some of this money into the betterment overall of their country's infrastructures.
2021, it'll be goodbye to Angela Merkel and hello to a new U.S. president. Well, should we say a familiar face, Joe Biden, 78 years old, has been in Washington since Richard Nixon was president. He knows, though, that it's a new era, and he knows also that he's got his work cut out.
I pledge to be a president who seeks not to divide, but unify, who doesn't see red states and blue states, only sees the United States. And work with all my heart, with the confidence of the whole people, to win the confidence of all of you. I sought this office to restore the soul of America, to rebuild the backbone of this nation, the middle class, and to make America respected around the world again.
Lila Jacinto, not red states, blue states. It's almost exactly the quote we heard from Barack Obama on election night in 2008.
Well, 2021 is going to be the year that Biden is going to have to put his money where his mouth is. You know, he won the election, but a lot of that victory was an anti-Trump vote. He's got the left flank of his party, the people who supported Bernie Sanders, who want to see, you know, far more liberal governance and administration, and particularly in the pandemic age. And Biden, in a way, it's great. He's a safe pair of hands. We know he absolutely knows his foreign policy. He was the Senate foreign policy head for many years. But will he really get the pulse of what Americans want?
Will he get the pulse of what Americans want, Borzu Dargahi?
My guess is no, I don't think so. I don't think that he will get in tune with the United States as it is now. Perhaps he will be prodded in the right direction by some of his advisors, but the idea that he can collaborate with the Republicans, with those red states, and come up with any kind of sort of compromise with them is, you know, ludicrous. I mean, Barack Obama tried to do that, and he tried that for 8 years, and he got nowhere. So if his strategy is not, how do I work against this, you know, almost evil, destructive force that has taken hold of this one half of this two-party system, and how do I undermine, subvert, sabotage them, and, you know, get them out of the picture in an almost a, you know, kind of a very scheming Machiavellian way. If that's not his attitude, he's not going to get anywhere.
All right.
Because,
so the acid,
you know, the Republican Party right now is out to, you know, kind of dismantle and destroy him, just as they tried to do to Obama.
And all right. So the acid test is a simple one, Borzu. What does he do about Donald Trump? Does he prosecute or does he pardon?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of different opinions. My, you know, personal, well-informed opinion is that he doesn't go after Trump himself for the sake of the country, but he, you know, does not block the various prosecutorial authorities from going after his deputies and minions and enablers.
Barbie Ladsen-Nadeau, I can't help but notice your publication does not handle the outgoing U.S. president with kid gloves. What do you do with all these legal cases that are sure to pile up after January the 20th?
Well, I agree. I think that you just sort of beat the drum around him, and you look at all of the, you know, the sort of easy, soft targets, and I think those will be the focus of the Biden administration. You know, but Trump's not going anywhere, and whether it's Donald Trump who runs in 2024 or you know, an offspring of his, Ivanka or something like that, you know, the family's not going to go away. And I think that the Biden administration is very wise to realize that they're going to be up against the Trump, you know, movement for a very long time, for the entire presidency and whatever comes after that.
All right. Joe Biden, who will have his work cut out, filling a lot of posts in the civil service that were left vacant, returning to the Paris Climate Accords. But he won't be reversing Trump's hawkish stance on China, nor will he be breaking with what the Trump administration called the Abraham Accords, that normalization of ties between Israel and Gulf states, which has been followed by normalization of ties between Israel and Sudan. And this 11th hour sweetener to full relations between Israel and Morocco, the United States recognizing Rabat's 1975 annexation of Western Sahara, thus reversing decades of diplomacy whereby Washington backed UN mediation in that former Spanish colony. What does he do there, Patrick Smith?
My hunch is that, as you say, he's going to keep with the Abraham Accords program, so he's not going to discourage Morocco's rapprochement with Israel. But my sense is that he will go back and say, look, the U.S. position has historically been to support the U.N. mediation process in Western Sahara, flawed and stalled as it is, and then revert back to that and perhaps come up with some sort of new initiative at the UNHQ. Biden has appointed a very experienced U.N. ambassador to UNHQ in New York, Linda Thomas Greenfield, who knows the Sahrawi dossier, knows Africa and the Middle East well, and I suspect they will then push for some new UN initiative on the process without sort of involving themselves in bilateral deals between Morocco and Israel.
Well, do they push a new initiative and thus run the risk of annoying Morocco, or Patrick, do they? Well, just simply let what Donald Trump promised about Western Sahara lie fallow.
I think, given that most of the states in the African Union still maintain that their support for the UN initiative, that's and would want to see some sort of UN brokered referendum or vote on the issue or some restart of talks between the Polisario and the Sahrawi people and the Moroccan government, I suspect that's where the U.S. would come down. But, you know, Biden's plate is going to be so full of a lot of very difficult foreign policy issues, I can't see they're going to spend a lot of time on it. But I don't think they'll just let that Trump sort of transactional deal between Morocco and the Western Sahara just continue without some sort of rebuttal.
Leo Jacinto, when it comes to the Middle East, it's not just about normalization of ties, it's about how you handle Iran. The year began with the killing of Qassem Soleimani, the senior commander of the Revolutionary Guards, by a U.S. drone. We had the killing of a nuclear scientist towards the end of the year. Has Donald Trump made it impossible for Joe Biden to return to the Iran nuclear deal?
Well, I mean, you're asking me to look into the crystal ball. I would think that on the foreign policy front, after getting back into the Paris Climate Accord, Iran would take up a lot of Biden's attention and certainly an effort to revive the JCPOA, the nuclear the deal that Trump got the U.S. out of. Only because Iran is facing so much pressure on so many borders, on its Afghan border, on its Iraq border, and a very destabilize an insecure Iran is a very dangerous entity, and Biden understands that very well. So the Trump policy of being very, very hard on Iran, Biden is going to have to walk that down back, but carefully.
But carefully, and it just doesn't all depend on whether or not returns to the nuclear deal on the United States. It also depends on Iran. We saw the recent hanging of journalist-turned-activist Ruhollah Zam. It was seen as a victory of the hardliners over the moderates in Tehran. He'd been lured to Iraq from Europe before popping up blindfolded on state television. That execution, Borzu Dargahi, does it tell you that, well, the hardliners have won the day and there'll be no going back to that nuclear deal or to some sort of compromise?
No, I don't think so. I think that... first of all, the nuclear deal is important to the Europeans, and it's extremely important to the Europeans. It's still viewed as a triumph of European diplomacy, and I think the Biden team definitely understands that. And they see restoring the JCPOA not just as a way of getting back into a deal that, you know, they themselves in many ways negotiated under the previous administration, but a way of restoring good relations and good communication with Europe and the rest of the NATO partners and so on. And so with one stroke of the pen, Biden can just sign an executive order saying all, you know, White House sanctions that were imposed after January 21st, 2017 are removed. And with that, Iran could quickly return to compliance in terms of its stockpile of weapons and its rate of producing enriched fissile material. And that could be very easily, and it could also be branded in both capitals, in Tehran, a great victory for Iran. We got the U.S. to go back to the deal. And in Washington, it could be branded as, you know, here's the first step towards coming up with a better deal, whether they end up coming up with that better deal or not.
But then in that case, how does Joe Biden handle the Saudis and the Israelis?
I mean, you just basically do what Obama did, which is, you know, where he comes from, which is, you know, sell them some weapons and tell them to, you know, relax.
Barbie Latsa-Nadeau, we said it earlier, one aspect on which Joe Biden won't be rolling back Donald Trump's legacy is getting tougher on China.
That's right. You know, I think Biden's surrounding himself. You see it already with very, very smart people and teams that are going to be able to help him through this, whereas Trump just unilaterally made a lot of decisions. I think Biden's, you know, approach to China is going to be one that a lot of people are watching as his first step, but potentially his first mistake, his first misstep, or his first real success. And he's, you know, he knows that. He's a politician for life now. He knows exactly what's going to make the people happy, what's going to make people calm down. He's going to know even what the opposition to him are looking for. And I think China holds the answer to all of those, how he handles that first step.
And will he, one of the biggest criticisms of Barack Obama was that when we were having all this talk when Obama was president of the G2, remember? That it was China and the U.S. working together, he got had.
Well, yeah, I mean, Joe Biden, though, it was a much more, I think, seasoned politician than Barack Obama, certainly. I think Biden understands this game a lot better, and I don't think he'll make some of the same mistakes that Obama made. He's done this for a lot longer. He knows the game.
Not just that, it's a very different time. Biden is coming into power not in 2017. He's coming into power in 2021. Beijing is an extremely different entity. And China is actually one of the things that actually unites people on the Republicans and the Democrats. There may be differences on how to handle the issue, but right now, there is more unity on China, and there's also unity internationally. Biden is going to, because China's neighbors are extremely alarmed with what is happening. Japan, Taiwan, India, and Biden can negotiate, at the very least, some sort of de-escalation on some of these tricky border areas with India, for instance. That could be on his plate. So in Beijing, I think that there was a sense of relief that, you know, Trump was not reelected. But I think this relief is really a miscalculation, because I don't see Biden getting any softer on China.
Patrick Smith, last week's show, you were saying how China rebounded better than a lot of people thought in terms of its public image in places like Africa. But as Leela just said, in Asia, it's turned off a lot of people with what some have branded its wolf warrior diplomacy, places like taking on Taiwan, of course, the crackdown in Hong Kong, and most recently, a trade war with Australia, which had asked it simply to investigate at the outset the origins of the COVID pandemic.
Right. I mean, in Southeast Asia, I don't think China is top of the pops by any means. And I think they're looking, I think, to the new Biden administration to give a lot more active support to their concerns. I mean, I guess they're betwixt and between. They don't want a full-on confrontation between the U.S. and China. Nobody wants that. But they want a more assertive U.S., I guess, in terms of what U.S. Liberal, quote-unquote, democratic values. So it's going to be interesting states like Japan, South Korea, Singapore, Taiwan, when Biden organizes his democracy summit next year, you know, are they going to show up and are they going to sort of make a point of being sort of we're pro-Biden, we're pro-democracy against China? It's going to be interesting to see how both China and the U.S. court their allies. I mean, I think that is the essential difference between the U.S. It's had, as Leela said, it's had, you know, decades of courting allies, forming coalitions. China's not so good at that, and particularly in its own neighborhood in Southeast Asia. So I think that is going to be the next stage of this rivalry between the two powers.
Yeah, Borsa Darkar, you agree?
Well, I mean, you know, the issue of China is not only a U.S. issue, and I think that is going to be a winning card for the Biden administration. There is more and more worry in Europe, more and more exploitable concern in Africa and Asia and Latin America about the bullying, the perceived bullying that China has engaged in. And for the United States, it's a, you know, way of re-entering the, you know, diplomatic corps. This was an issue that, you know, the Trump administration, maybe to many people, it was right on the principles, but just completely wrong on the tone. And, you know, the sort of use of racist terminology like Kung Flu in describing the coronavirus. It was just, you know, not the way to go about this issue. But, you know, addressing the issue of the belligerence of China with diplomatic language and diplomatic tools is a winning card for the Biden administration.
And yet, just one final parenthesis, if you will, on this. We saw 2 weeks ago here in France, they're building Huawei's first factory outside of China, this at a time when more and more countries are saying no to Chinese technology because of security concerns.
This is going to be another thing to watch, whether the markets will be driven by policy this year, because much of the opening up to China, which was the U.S. opening up, was the rush for markets. And with Huawei, you know, Canada is it got embroiled in this problem, and had many Canadian citizens were also arrested. So I think what we're going to have to see in China is what Biden manages in terms of policy versus the push of the markets.
All right. What a difference a year makes. At this time in December of 2019, the world was toasting the Nobel Peace Prize winner. Remember, it was Ethiopia's prime minister. Now, Abiy Ahmed is no longer brokering peace in Khartoum. Instead, it was images like this one, Sudan's leader making the trip instead to Addis Ababa and to try to mediate in a conflict where there were atrocities. As the province of Tigray rebelled against the capital. Patrick Smith, will 2021 be a good or bad year for Ethiopia?
Well, I think everyone is hoping, most of all Ethiopians are hoping it's going to be the route out of this crisis. I think politically, the invasion of Tigray by the federal government has got to the core of how Ethiopia is going to be run. You've got several other restive regions, Oromia, Ogaden, near the near Somalia. And I think Abiy has to face that politically. He wants, many people believe, to go back to a much more unitary state, going back to the days of a kind of imperial Ethiopia, where the country was run by from Addis Ababa, essentially, and to forgo the devolution and the federalism.
Because there's two schools of thought on this, isn't there? There's two schools of thought because the Tigrayans, what, a little over 5% of Ethiopia's population, and yet they'd had outsized power for decades.
No, I'm sure. I mean, I think that he has a lot of supporters who say that this minority had dominated security, dominated the military, and it was completely out of order. And that the final straw was with this apparent attack by Tigrayan troops on federal troops. No question about that. But I think at the same time, the regions also want to maintain the rights, so the political and economic rights they've assumed over the last 20 years. So I think that there's going to be a difficult balancing act between the center in Addis Ababa and the regions of the country, and how to make them work together more harmoniously and hopefully more pacifically.
Right now, the military upper hand is with Addis Ababa. Lila Jacinto, a few months ago, before that push, there was worry about what the future of Ethiopia as a state was.
Yes, because as Patrick says, this entire federal system and the TPLF having so many, having the military strength that it does. This also has implications for neighboring countries and the entire Horn of Africa region. You've got refugees in Sudan. There were reports of Eritrean troops joining federal forces. And the fact that this military operation was conducted under a complete communications blackout, which makes it very hard for the international community to actually see what is happening on the ground, and Ethiopia, Addis Ababa is the headquarters of the African Union. It is an extremely important country in this region. So the ramifications for the region are extremely difficult. And how Abiy manages this, because he certainly in 2020 he got a real soft power blow by the way this operation was conducted. This is a Nobel Peace Prize winner, so it sort of opened it opened the world's eyes to the limitations of a Nobel Peace Prize winner again.
Yeah, Barbie Latsanado. There was he said something like Ethiopia doesn't need babysitters.
Right, but I think we're missing the point a little bit on this. The humanitarian crisis that this conflict is causing or will continue to cause is going to be a huge topic in 2021 for the entire region. And you see little whispers about it right now, how the world is going to address that and handle it. But we've seen time and time again that a conflict like this produces a problem, global problem, when it comes to the overall humanitarian issue with it. And you see the refugee situation just getting worse, and that's not going to go away in 2021. That's going to be a huge issue in 2021.
A huge issue. Barbie Latsanado, we have a holiday tradition at the World this week, which is on the last show of the year. We ask the panel for their book or movie or song that will help us prepare for the year to come. What is your choice, madame?
My choice of book is How to Do Nothing, and that is Resisting the Attention Economy. And, we've seen lots of things over this pandemic where everybody's telling you to unplug and get away from social media and all of that. This book I liked so much because it tells you about how you should reset your relationship with your devices, that you're no longer going to be sort of a slave to the notifications, or that you're going to obsess about what's trending. It's about how to take control of your own narrative of your attention. It's about, you know, finding spontaneity. Can we travel again? Can we do things again? And, you know, we know that we've been also focused on the news of the pandemic, whether it's the, you know, the way it was spreading in the beginning, the lockdowns, the vaccine, all these sorts of things. In 2021, if we all follow the advice in this book, we will decide what we focus on, and not our devices.
Does that mean weaning ourselves off these anxiety-producing, triggering devices? Have you been following the book's advice, Barbie?
It's not 2021 yet, so I'll let you know.
Okay. Let me ask you, Borzu Daragahi, what should we do, see, or watch to get ready for the year to come?
Well, my suggestion is a little bit more grim. There was a BBC HBO series called Years and Years that followed the trajectory of a family in the middle UK as the following years came about, like that 15 following years, and it was just an extraordinary six-part miniseries, and just, you know, horrible things became mundane and normal, and, you know, began affecting this normal middle-class family's life. You know, the President Mike Pence kicks the UN out of New York. There's a nuclear attack on a Chinese island by the U.S. There is a run on banks in the UK, and, you know, a family savings collapses, and the guy is forced to become like a Uber driver, or a bicycle Uber delivery guy, you know, and just these, you know, terrible things keep happening, and, you know, just jaw-dropping events, and that is basically becoming our new normal at this point, and that's what we have to sort of get used to.
The series is British. Do they keep a stiff upper lip?
The family, no. I mean, they are pretty. They get pretty emotional. There's, you know, they don't keep a stiff upper lip. They become pretty dramatic in facing these crises.
Patrick Smith, what should we do to keep a stiff upper lip or not in 2021?
Well, an Italian friend gave me this book by the novelist Italo Calvino. It's entitled Six Memos for the New Millennium. What was remarkable about it is it was written in 1983, shortly before his tragic death. But I found it, it's 100 pages long. And each chapter is incredibly perceptive and elucidating, as far as I'm concerned. It talks about the virtues of lightness, quickness, multiplicity, exactitude, and visibility, and draws on diverse forms of art, the folktale, the bande dessinée, comic strips, and so on, to get his message across. So I would really recommend it to viewers. It's absolutely a stepping back from the current crisis that we're in and looking at the essence of human existence, what the things that are truly valuable to enable you to withstand these times. And I think we need more books like that to actually get us to pull back from the crisis and see what we should be doing as humans.
All right. Lila Jacinto, I notice there's a recurring theme here with how-to guides for the coming year.
Oh, when it comes to stepping back, my recommendation is a complete step back. I'm stepping back to 5th century BC.
Are you now?
I am. Well, my book recommendation is Thucydides, the Peloponnesian Wars. That's the war between Athens and Sparta. And I'm recommending this because last year I heard so much and I read the book by Graham Allison. It's Destined for War. And there was a lot of talk about the Thucydides trap, you know, can these two powers of America and China go to war in the same way that Athens and Sparta went to war? Graham Allison and Thucydides' contention is that it's fear that drives countries to war. So a rising Athens made Sparta so fearful that a war was inevitable. And Graham Allison's book, but this is another book, Destined to War, posited this theory that, you know, China is rising and could there be a war between the U.S. And China? And at some point, I got a bit tired of the Thucydides trap being talked about because I felt it sort of denied China responsibility for its actions, and we were trapped in the trap. And so I went back to 4th century B.C., and it is a remarkable book.
All right, and it proves again that the future is unwritten.
And that human behavior does not change.
Does not change much. Leela Jacinto, I want to thank very much. Barbie Latsenado for being with us from Rome. Borzu Daragahi in Istanbul. Patrick Smith in London.
That's all right.
A happy end of the year to all of you. Thank you for being with us here throughout the year in The World This Week.